97.5 FM, Statenville, Valdosta, Georgia. Foxy 97.5 FM.
Pastors, ministers, leaders, help hurting people God's way. Become a board-certified Christian counselor. Victorious Living Bible Institute, in partnership with the National Association of Christian Counselors, teaches the following: formal training that will help maximize your counseling ministry, learn to counsel in a Christ-centered format, gain understanding of legal, ethical, and moral issues relative to Christian counseling, learn how to respond to a crisis and know when to refer, help individuals, marriages, and families thrive. There will be a 10-week live Zoom instruction. Classes to begin Monday, April 3rd. Renee Sellers is the certified trainer. Register today at www.victoriouslbi.org/Christian-counseling. Victorious Living Bible Institute is an affiliate of Christian Bible Institute and Seminary. Command your morning devotion and prayer live at 5 o'clock a.m. Monday through Friday at WHLJ 97.5 FM in Valdosta and Moultrie, Georgia. Also on Facebook Live on Mondays. You can also tune in by going to www.foxy97.com or call in 267-807-9611, access code 266-590. Evangelist Renee Sellers is your host.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. This is Evangelist Renee Sellers. Of the Upper Room Outreach Ministries in Waycross, Georgia, where my pastor is Pastor Samuel Sellers III. And we're live this morning on this Faith in It Friday. Yes, Mr. Lee, Faith in It Friday. And we're excited to have a special man of God who is going to minister to us today, who is gifted with the has the strong gift of exhortation, the ability to encourage the people. We're live on WHLJ 97.5 FM, Statenville, Valdosta, Moultrie, Georgia. You can also join us online this morning at Foxy, FOXY97.com. And you can also join us on the conference call at 267-807-9611, access code 266-590. This is another day that the Lord has made. Somebody ought to say, I'm going to rejoice and I'm going to be glad in it. This morning as we prepare, we have Pastor Nathaniel Anderson of Evergreen Church Ministries, Bristol, Georgia, Highway 32, the Church Alive, is worth the drive. He's going to share with us this morning, and we're excited about this. This is the husband of Lady Emily Anderson, who, and neither of them are strangers to Command Your Morning. So we're excited about that. I want to encourage you to grab your notepad, grab your pen, grab your Bibles, as he gets ready to share a word of encouragement with us today. But before he begins, I'm going to ask Evangelist Paulette Griffin to open us up with a word of prayer at 5:30. At 5:30, we'll take a break for station ID, and then we'll give Pastor Anderson a few more minutes to encourage the people of God. So join in, wake somebody up, let them know we are live at 5. Evangelist Paulette Griffin, open us up with a word of prayer. The next voice you hear will be Pastor Nathaniel Anderson. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We bless your name. We praise you, Lord God, for you are our Father which art in heaven. Holy is your name. We give you praise this morning, Lord, for you are good. You are merciful. We rise early this morning to make known our adoration to you. During the fourth watch of the morning, we get up. We make time for you, Lord God, and we bless your name, for you are Elohim. You are El Shaddai. You are Jehovah Jireh. You are Jehovah Nissi. We bless your name, Lord God. You are Jehovah Shalom, our peace, and we thank you for being that peace, oh God, not just giving us peace, but being our peace in the name of Jesus. We give you praise and glory, for you are Jehovah Shammah. You will never leave us nor forsake us, and we bless your name as we commit this broadcast to you this morning. We ask that you have your way. We ask that you use your servant mightily this morning to minister to the hearts of the hearers, and that the hearers be receptive to what the Spirit of the Lord has to say. In Jesus' name, can somebody shout amen? Good morning, Pastor Anderson. We welcome you this morning, and the broadcast is yours. God bless you.
Good morning, Pastor Sellers, Evangelist Sellers. I thank the Lord for the opportunity to be here this morning and speak on Command Your Morning. I'll try to cover what I have to say in the time limited, and I told my wife I may even come up short. But I want to start out in the book Galatians chapter number 4, beginning at verse 1. It says, what I am saying is that as long as an heir is underage, he is no different from a slave, although he owns the whole estate. The heir is subject to guardians and trustees until the time set by the father. So also we, when we were underage, we were in slavery under the elemental spiritual forces of the world. But when the set time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, under the law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive adoption of sonship. Because you are sons, God sent the spirit of his son into our hearts, the spirit who calls out, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but God's child. And since you are his child, God has made you also an heir. My topic this morning is being in control of your inheritance. Just because you have an inheritance does not mean that you are in control of it. There are things that we have to do to take charge and take over and show that we are the rightful heirs and operate under the authority that God has given us as children of God. The Word of God says that we are heirs of God and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. The Scripture tells us that the earth is the Lord's, the fullness thereof, the earth and all that dwells in it. Everything that belongs to God belongs to Jesus. And everything that belonged to Jesus belonged to us as children of God, and we are joint heirs with him. Over in the Scripture in 1 Corinthians chapter number 3, Paul talked to the church at Corinth, because that was a very confused church, and he began to try to explain to them. They were arguing over who was following Paul and who's following Apollos, but he gave them in verse 21, he says, therefore let no man glory in men, for all things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas or the world, listen, or life or death or things present or things to come, all are yours. He is saying here that the world is yours. He's saying that life is yours, death is yours. And then it says, and ye are Christ's, and Christ is God's. So therefore, we have to understand who we are in Christ Jesus and walk in the authority that God has given us. But our authority is limited by our faith, and our faith is limited by our knowledge. When I first came to Evergreen Church as pastor, I had never pastored anywhere, and I had not been to a seminary school. But however, I had been saved for quite a while, for many years, and operated in the church, and I was under some good teachers and tutors and great men and women of God. But I asked God, Lord, what do you want me as a pastor to teach the people? What do you want me to minister to them? And the Lord spoke to me very clearly. He says, teach them about Jesus. And I said, yes, Lord, but what do you want me to teach them about Jesus? He said, teach them how to live in victory. See, God wants us as children to live victorious Christian lives, not as victims, always complaining to God about what and to everybody else about what God is doing and how hard life is for us. The scripture tells us that the way of a transgressor is hard. If everything is always so hard in our lives and we are saved and we are children of God, we need to take a personal inventory of our own lives and see where we are, because we are supposed to be living in victory. We're supposed to be walking in authority. So we need to see if we are walking in the authority that we have as heirs of God and as children of God. After Jesus' resurrection, he gave his disciples power. He arose from the dead and said, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. He gave us power over all the enemies. Now, that power that he gave, speaking to his disciples, passed down, is perpetual. The power didn't stop with those 12 disciples that they had chosen and those that were in the upper room. It goes perpetually to all the children of God. And so we have to realize the authority that we have in Christ as his children. And if we have power and authority and don't know how to use it, we'll still be defeated. If we have power and authority and we don't know that we have the power or authority, we'll still live defeated lives. And God wants us to be the example for the world. God don't want us to be envying the world. God wants the world to be looking at us so that they can see the power and authority that we live in. Then we can tell them about Jesus. We can tell them the source of our power. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse number 57, he says, but thanks be unto God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. You see, we as Christians, we don't have to try to get the victory. When we get saved, the victory is given to us. Our job, our responsibility is to hold on to the victory that God has given us. And just like in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve already had everything that they needed. They were already in authority. They already had dominion. But Satan talked to Eve, and he convinced her to want what she already got and do something different to try to get what she already got. So what we have to realize is who we already are in Christ Jesus, and realize that in every battle, we start out with the victory. We just have to hold on to it. Now, in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14, he says, now thanks be unto God, which always causes us to triumph in Christ. We have got to have the mindset and view ourselves as children of God, walking in the power and authority of God. Our Father owns everything, and God has given us his power and his authority through Christ Jesus in the earth. One of my favorite scriptures, and one that we use continually at Evergreen, is Philippians chapter 4:13, where he says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. What we have to do is learn not to depend upon our own ability, not depend upon our own strength, and not look at ourselves and realize that our strength is in Christ. No matter what the situation is, Christ is more than able. He has caused us to be more than conquerors through Christ, because we have our power and authority in him. We have access to his power. Therefore, we don't look at our power and our ability. We look at him. I can do all things, but it doesn't mean that I will do all things. I have to know that I have the ability to do it. I have to know how to use the ability to do it. If I don't, then I will be made captive to Satan. See, there is a power in every born-again believer that we have not yet tapped into. There is a potential that's lying dormant in every one of us. We have power yet to be released in our lives. We have not become the best that we can be yet. There is so much power and authority in us. That's why Paul says, I can do all things. He didn't put a limit on it. He said, I can do all things, but the only way I can do it is through Christ who is in me. Now, in the book of Hosea, chapter number 4, he says, my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. See, they were not destroyed for a lack of ability. They were not destroyed because the enemy was so much greater. The Bible said they were destroyed for a lack of knowledge. Knowledge is power. Knowledge opens up our understanding so we can release what we already have on the inside of us. We don't have to try to get the power. What we have to do is learn how to operate in the power that God has already given us through Christ Jesus. And this is for born-again believers. It's not for the world. The world is in a helpless situation. One of the scriptures that I think is most misunderstood in the Bible is the book of Romans chapter 7, in the verse where Paul says, when I would do good, evil is before me. The good that I would, I don't do. The evil that I didn't want to do, I find myself doing it. O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this body of death? Well, I've talked to some of my Christian brothers, and they are believing and they teach that that's the state that we still live in, even after being saved. But my favorite chapter, if anybody asks you what is Pastor Anderson's favorite chapter, you tell them Romans chapter 6. Because Romans chapter 6 lets us know that sin shall not have dominion over you. Romans chapter 6 said, therefore being set free from sin, and it's talking about free from the power of sin, not free from the presence of sin. But he said, therefore being set free from sin, you can have your fruit unto righteousness, and you can live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. If you're still doing what you don't want to do, then that means you are not in control. If you're still doing things that you don't want to do, you are not in control. Jesus Christ came and he set us free. But we have to learn how to walk in the freedom that he has given us. We are not still in bondage. We should not be saying, I want to do right, but I can't. I don't want to do wrong, but I have to do it. We are no longer in bondage. In Romans chapter 6, it says, sin shall not have dominion over you. In Romans chapter 7, Paul was talking about how we were before we got saved. Let me see if I can turn to that right quick. Romans chapter 7 and verse number 5. He says, for when we were in the flesh. Now, I'm looking at the NIV, so it's not reading like I normally have in the King James Version or New King James Version, but I think we'll still get the same understanding. It says, for when we were in the realm of the flesh, the sinful passions aroused by the law were at work in us when we were in the flesh. Now, Paul let them know that you are not in the flesh now, but you are in the spirit. See, Romans chapter 8 tells us about the victory that we have because we are not in the flesh, but in the spirit. And because of the spirit, now we can walk in the victory that God has given us. Whereas in Romans chapter number 7, it talks about when we were in bondage. Now, in that fifth verse, I'm going to read it again. It says, for when we were in the realm of the flesh, the sinful passions aroused by the law were at work in us. So we bore fruit that brought forth death. So that's the way we lived before we got into Christ Jesus. That's how we lived before the power of God operated in our lives. What we have to realize is that we are the children of God. When we accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior in our lives, he sends forth his spirit into our spirit, making us born again. And the power that sin had over us before we were born again has been broken by the power of the Holy Spirit. By his grace, we can live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. I know that I thank God for grace, and nobody can make it without grace. But we have got teachers now in the body of Christ that spend so much time talking about grace that they lead people to believe that holiness is an option now. But the Bible tells us to be holy. It says, be ye holy, for I am holy. And without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. Well, God equips us to live a holy life in this present world. And we have to realize, listen, if I say I can do all things through Christ, that means I can live right. That does not mean, if I can do all things through Christ, why am I doing what I don't want to do? If I can do all things, why am I not doing what I'm supposed to do? If I can do all things, why am I held in bondage? We have to realize who we are in Christ Jesus and walk into the promises and walk into the benefits that God has given us as children of God. In the book of Isaiah, chapter 5 and verse 13, God says, therefore, my people have gone into captivity because they have no knowledge. Sickness and diseases can be captivity. Poverty and lack can be captivity. Mental instability can be captivity. Hatred, jealousy, strife, ungodliness, fornication, all these things can be captivity. But we are captive because we don't realize the power of God that's operating on the inside of us. Jesus said, whosoever the Son sets free is free indeed, which means we are truly free. We do not have to live in bondage. We are children of the Most High God. Somebody said that you can put a blind man behind bars, and you can actually leave the door unlocked, and he won't even try to escape because he can't see. I remember when I was younger, and I visited some guys that lived down the road from me, and we played basketball, and their basketball court was in the backyard, and the basketball went into the field, which was behind their house. And in the field, they had cows back there, but the only thing that kept the cows in the field was what they had called an electric fence. An electric fence was just one strip of wire that went across the front that was supposed to keep the cows in the field. Well, the basketball went across the fence. And I was going to get the basketball, but when I saw the wire, I stopped. And one of the guys told me, said, you can go ahead on. He said, the electricity not on, so you can go ahead on and get the basketball. I asked him, I said, well, what keep the cows in the field if the electricity is not on? He said, the cows don't know it's not on. So the cows have probably bumped up against that wire once or twice. And now where they can go out and they can get free, they don't because they don't know that they can be free. Jesus Christ has set us free in the body of Christ. And we need to learn to walk in the freedom and authority that he has given us. In the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 4, it says, the God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. A lack of knowledge of the word of God is what keeps unsaved people unsaved. They don't realize the joy that comes with salvation. They don't realize the peace that comes with salvation. They don't realize the benefits that come with salvation. The world has nothing to offer them greater than what God has, but they don't understand the things of God, and they think that they have to live, in order to live and enjoy their life, they have to follow after the pleasures of the flesh. But there is a pleasure that comes in godliness that supersedes the pleasures of the world. And everything in the world belongs to us too. God wants us to have nice houses. He wants us to have nice cars. But he don't want any of those things to have us. And God will bless us with as much as we can stand and still put him first. So we don't have to deny God and godliness to enjoy the things of the world, because Paul already told them, say, the world is yours anyway. You just got to learn how to pick out the good and leave the evil, because the evil is going to pull you down while the good will raise you up, and then you can enjoy the things in this world and still have eternal life. Now, a lack of knowledge of the word of God has also blinded many believers and brought forth destruction and captivity into their lives. Just because you are saved does not mean you are living according to the benefits that God has given us. In the book of Hebrews, the Apostle Paul, well, we say, maybe Paul didn't write Hebrews. Nobody exactly knows who wrote the book of Hebrews. But in the book of Hebrews, the author was frustrated with his audience. And in the fifth verse, he told them, says, by the time that you have been saved, you ought to be teachers. You need someone else to teach you again the first principles of God. You forgot the very foundation that you were laid upon, and that is upon the faith of Christ Jesus. And there's a difference between faith in Christ Jesus and the faith of Christ Jesus. Faith in Christ Jesus is what you get saved. It's called what caused you to be saved. The faith of Christ Jesus is what caused you to receive the benefits that come with being saved. And he told them, you have need of milk and not solid food. He said, for everyone who partakes only of milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, for he is a baby. But solid food belongs to those who are of full age, and those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. The victory of a Christian comes with knowing the word of God, believing the word of God, and applying the word of God to your life. James says faith without works is dead. That means that there should be some evidence to go along with your faith in order for your faith to be alive. Faith without works, dead faith, is when you believe right, but you don't have any corresponding action to go with what you say you believe. When you believe the word of God, the first thing comes with knowing. The Bible says faith comes by hearing the word of God, so you've got to be exposed to the word of God. Once you are exposed to the word of God, then you got to believe what you have been taught. Believe the word of God. Then let the word of God be your guideline for the choices that you make. Then you are operating in faith. Then you are living in faith. Just because you believe right does not mean you have faith. Faith is always have a corresponding action to go with it in order for it to be a living faith. And he says that the word of God, solid food, belongs to those who are full age, who by reason of use. In other words, you know the word of God and then you use the word of God. Now, over in the book of 1 Peter, chapter number 2, and it's 5:29 right now, so I know I guess I need to stop for the station identification.
Amen, Pastor. Thank you so much. To God be, I told you all we were going to be encouraged in our faith this morning. To God be the glory. We are listening to Pastor Nathaniel Anderson of Evergreen Church Ministries, Bristol, Georgia. The church alive is worth the drive. And he's sharing with us from the subject, being in control of your inheritance, being in control of your inheritance. He says our authority is limited by our faith. Our faith is limited by our knowledge. And there's one more point to that that I didn't catch, because I already, Pastor Anderson, have, oh God, going on 5 pages of notes. But we're live at 5 on WHLJ, 97.5 FM, Statenville, Valdosta, Moultrie, Georgia. You can also join us online this morning at Foxy, FOXY97.com. And you can also join us on the conference call at 267 407-9611, access code 266-590. If you would like or encouraged to sow into Command Your Morning, if you're encouraged to sow into this word this morning, we're going to encourage you to visit our website at theupperroomwaycross.com and go to the link that says give. Once you go to that link that says give, something will pop up that says PayPal or Givelify, and you can give online. For those of us that would like to partner with Command Your Morning, help support this radio ministry, you can set up monthly contributions. You can also mail your donation to 702 Ozzie Davis Parkway, Waycross, Georgia, 31501. Please put attention, Finance Department or Miranda White. We're excited this morning to have Pastor Anderson continue to encourage us with the word being in control of your inheritance. God bless you, Pastor Anderson.
All malice and all guile and hypocrisies and envies and all evil speaking, as newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the word that you might grow thereby. God is expecting growth in us. And growth starts with the sincere milk of the word, the basic things of the word. Start laying aside the things in your life that you know are ungodly. God is not going to take away the sin out of your life. God gives you ability to have power over the sin. He said for us to lay it aside. You have to make up in your mind that as a newborn babe and as a child of God, these things no longer belong to me. So I'm going to lay aside all malice and guile and hypocrisy. Be real. Stop. Don't be pretending. And don't be envious of other people. And he says evil speaking. Evil speaking sometimes does not mean that you are lying. Sometimes evil speaking simply means you're saying something that's contrary to what God has said. The Bible talks about how when the children of Israel went to spy out in the promised land, he sent out 12 spies. The Bible says 10 of them came back with an evil report. Now, the ones that came back, they told what they saw. They saw how the land was good. They saw the Philistines. They saw the giants in the land. But their perception of it was contrary to what God had said. Then you had two others, Joshua and Caleb. They saw the very exact same thing that the other 10 saw, but they brought back a good report. In other words, they brought back a report saying what God said. All of them saw the same thing, and all of them were saying what was true. But the thing is, the truth, the faith circumvents your situation and your circumstances. You have evil speaking is when you say something contrary to what God has said. God has let you know that you are a conqueror. You are more than a conqueror. So your life should not be a defeated, ungodly lifestyle. And when you say, I can't, when God says you can, that's an evil report. So he says, put away that evil speaking. And then he says, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word that you may grow thereby. Now, as a pastor, one of the things that bless me so much is when I see people have a desire for the word of God. Now, I'm one of those preachers that I don't need any amens. If you say amen to me, that's fine. Well, I need to be able to look out there and see that I have your attention. I just have to look out there and see that you are listening to what I have to say. That's what stirs me up. That's what motivates me. That let me know that you have a hunger for the things of God. And if you have a hunger for the things of God, God will continue to feed me so that I can feed you the word of God. But if you don't have a hunger, if while I'm teaching and ministering the word of God, you're sitting there playing on your cell phone or you having a sidebar conversation, then that cuts off, that hinders the anointing that's in me because it's telling me you're not hungry. So the word of God, the Bible says, desire the sincere milk, desire the things of God. And the more you desire the things of God, the more God will bless you, and the more he will fill you. And the more he fills you, the more you grow. And the more you grow, the more victory you will have in Christ Jesus. You see, spiritual growth is essential to our being in control of the inheritance that God has given us. He said that even though a child may be the heir of the entire estate, they don't have any authority over anything they got because they have not reached the full age yet. And that's why right now there are so many things that God wants to give us that he cannot give us because we're not ready yet. The scripture over in 1 Corinthians, I believe that's 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse number 9. I want to read that. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, beginning at verse 9. He said, "But as it is written, I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him." Now, many times people will stop right there on that particular verse, but they need to read the next verse following behind that, which says, "But God has revealed them to us by his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yea, the deep things of God." The things that God wants us to have, we receive them by his Spirit. His Spirit makes us conscious, God conscious, of the things that God has for us. And as we study the Word of God, we'll find that the things that God has for us are hidden in a mystery in the Word of God. And the more you learn the Word of God, the more God will reveal to you the things that are hidden. But if you just take time to just bathe and be comfortable in what you see and what you have, you'll never be able to understand, you'll never be able to receive the things that God has in store for us. And it continue to seek after God, and the more we seek after God, the more things will seek after us. We're supposed to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Then all the things that are hidden, the things that are mysterious, God will begin to reveal to us, because God revealed them to us by his Spirit. And you got to have a hunger for God and the things of God. And God see your hunger, and God see your desire. The scripture says, "Delight yourself in the Lord, and he'll give you the desires of your heart." The desires of your heart are given to you when you delight in the Lord. The Bible says, "If you abide in me and my word abide in you, ask what you will and it shall be done." The scripture said that God will withhold no good thing from them that love him. So all we have to do is learn how to love God, learn how to put God as first priority in our lives. And don't seek after things. Things will come. God wants you to enjoy the benefits of the world. God didn't put all these beautiful things in the world for the unsaved. He put these things in the world for us. They just get the side benefits, but they were given to us. But we have to know how to get them in a godly, righteous way. See, Satan gives people shortcuts. Satan can cause you to have money. He can cause you to have pleasures, but everything that Satan gives you have you want to pay for it. Like they say, if you dance to the music, you're going to pay the piper. Satan have a trap set, and he'll give you the pleasures of sin for a season, so you can pay for it in eternal damnation. But we can have the same pleasures and joy in righteousness, and then in the end have eternal life. Don't be deceived by Satan and think that you only have to get things the way he say that you can get it. You can receive the same things in the right way and enjoy the benefits. All right? And I'm going to look at one more scripture, and then I'm going to stop unless I need to stop before then. 2 Peter chapter 1 and verses, 2 Peter chapter 1. Beginning at verse 2, he says, "Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord." The first time I read that scripture, it about blew my mind. Grace can be multiplied. Now, see, we need grace, and grace is undeserved favor of God. I tell you right now, I'm God's favorite child. Why? Because he has given me his grace. And then the more I learn about God, the more grace I can receive. Because it says grace and peace is multiplied through the knowledge of God. That means a lack of grace and a lack of peace come from a lack of knowledge. It says, according as his divine power has given unto us all things that pertain to life and godliness, how? Through the knowledge of him that has called us to glory and virtue. Now, that's another scripture that blew my mind. It says that God has given unto us. Now, English was not one of my best subjects, but I realized that when it says it has done it, that means it's in the past. God has already given unto us by his divine power all things that pertain to life. Well, what pertain to life? Your food, your shelter, your clothing. All these things pertain to life. The Bible says God has already given them to us. And all things that pertain to godliness. Well, what's godliness? Righteousness, holiness, everything that we need to live a saint, a saved, sanctified life has already been given to us. But we receive it through the knowledge of God. Ignorance of the word of God is not your friend. In verse 4, he says, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. We as Christians realize that we always have our human nature. Now, I believe that when we get saved, our sin nature has been put to death. But we still have our human nature. And your human nature is going to operate by human intellect, using knowledge. What we think, what we can see, taste, touch, smell, hear with our five senses. And so we make decisions based upon what we perceive with our five senses. That's human intellect. But the Bible tells us that we have been made partakers of his divine nature. And the divine nature supersedes the human nature. So we have to realize that we need our human nature, but when human nature come in conflict with our divine nature, then we got to decide that we are going to live after the things of God, not the things that make sense, but the things that make faith. And faith supersedes senses. Senses can give you the facts, but faith can change the facts. Something that is a fact today may not be a fact tomorrow because God changed it from what it was to what it is. So we have to learn how to operate by faith. Living by faith is living by what God says in spite of what it looked like. The Bible talks about how Abraham, the Bible lets us know that Abraham looked beyond the situation and the circumstances and looked at what God said, being fully persuaded that whatever God had promised, he is also able to perform. Now, this scripture tells us that God has given to us exceeding great and precious promises. God has already given to us. See, we have to learn the difference between the spirit realm and the natural realm, because in the spirit, everything has already been done. God has already given us everything that we need. Well, if God has given it to us and we have not received it, then it's not a giving problem on God's part. It's a receiving problem on our part. By grace, God has already provided. He has already given us. We have a storehouse of wealth. We have a storehouse of everything that we need already given. But you got to transfer it from the storehouse to your house. We have to get, it's just like right now, if you have $1 million in the bank and you go to Walmart and you need a loaf of bread and you don't have a dime in your pocket, it don't mean you don't have the money. It just means you don't have it in your pocket. To get it to Walmart from the bank, we have what's called a debit card. And that debit card give me access to the $1 million. So I can use my debit card and transfer from the bank to Walmart for what I need. Your faith transfers what God has already given you from the spirit to the natural. That's why we have to learn that when we speak by the Spirit, we'll say things that might sound foolish in the natural. That's why the Bible says, let the weak say I'm strong. Well, if you're weak and you say you're strong in the natural, that means you must be lying. But by faith, you're not counting on the physical spirit in your human body. You're counting on the power of God that's at work on the inside of you. I can do all things through Christ who strengthened me. I have strength that you don't see. I have strength that I don't see. I have strength that I have access to that I have not even used yet. So when I speak in faith, I transfer that strength that's in Christ in me. So now I can do it, but I can only do it through the strength that he has. When you speak in faith, you sound foolish. That's why you can ask somebody how they're doing and how they feel, and they say, well, the doctor says I have cancer, and the doctor says I'm sick, and they say, well, the doctor lying. No, that doctor not lying. That doctor is giving you natural information. What you have to do is turn that natural information into what God has said. The scripture says, by his stripes we are healed. Now, I have to believe that I'm healed when the sickness is still in my body. Well, why can I believe that I'm healed when the sickness is in my body? The sickness is in the natural. The healing is in the spirit. I just have to transfer from the spirit to the natural what God has given me. My sickness is hiding behind my faith. My sickness is hiding behind what God has already said. When I put what God has said as first place in my life, I begin to see the promises of God manifested. See, he has already given them, but they are not yet manifested. When I pray for people, and I still believe divine healing belongs to the church. I believe it belongs to the people of God. And when I pray for people, I tell them, I says, all right, I'll let them make a confession. And when they make the confession, confess, Lord, I thank you for my healing. I thank you that by your stripes I am healed. And when you make that confession, you may not see the healing right then, but the healing is taking place in your body, and it will be manifested if you hold on to your confession and walk by faith and not by sight. You walk by what God said, not by what you feel and not by what you believe. That's how we operate in faith. And operating in faith sounds foolish to the unsaved. But when you learn that there is a spirit realm where everything has already been given, and you realize that your faith transfers what God has already given you in the spirit into the natural, then you just have to believe it and wait for the manifestation. Just because you don't see it don't mean that you don't have it. See, the Bible says through faith and patience we receive the promises of God. God has already given it, but we have to learn to receive it. Now, I don't know how much time I got, but I know it's only about 10 minutes left. Those evangelists tell me what to do.
As you are led by the Holy Spirit, if you have anything else for us, Pastor, forward to head. Amen.
All right. There's a movie called Shawshank Redemption, one of my favorite movies. And in that movie, a man that has spent most of his life in prison. He was a prison librarian, and he had learned and just developed his life in prison. But one day they decided to give him a parole and release him from prison. Well, after he was released from prison, only a short while later, he hanged himself. And when he hanged himself, the word got back to the prisoners. And in that movie, Morgan Freeman was one of the prisoners. And Morgan Freeman said that this guy had become institutionalized. In other words, he had learned to live in the prison system, but he did not know how to live out in the free world. So when he was out in the free world, he took his life because he did not know how. Many Christians have been in bondage for so long that it has become a lifestyle. Almost every time you talk to them, they tell you how bad things are. And you got some people that they will say, I'm blessed and highly favored. And you know they're going through some things, but they're not looking at the things. They're looking at what God has said. So we have to learn how to transform, how to transition our life, transition our perception, and to begin to think like God thinks. And the only way we can think like God thinks is to know his word and have his spirit on the inside of us. Many Christians have become so in so much bondage. But I want you to know that Jesus Christ came that we might have life and that we might have it in abundance. So in my conclusion, I'm going to say this. Let's grow up and let's receive our inheritance. Let's fight the good fight of faith and lay hold on eternal life. We are sons and daughters of the living God, and we already have the victory in Christ Jesus. Father God, I thank you right now for the word that you have given me to give your people, and I pray, Father God, that it has fallen on good ears, that we are grounds for a harvest of your word, and we will realize that as command your morning continue to be on the air and encourage people and strengthen people, that we will grow from being victims to being victorious in every area of our lives. So, Lord, I just thank you, and I give you praise, honor, and glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, evangelist.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor. Thank you, Pastor. Ladies and gentlemen, being in control of your inheritance was the subject today. And if you are like me, you have been tremendously blessed by this solid food, this solid meal that we have received this morning, this sound teaching that we have received this morning. So I want to encourage you this morning to stand on the Word of God, because Pastor Anderson lets us know that for the believers, victory for the believers comes with knowing the Word, believing, and applying the Word. And he talked about evil speech, saying something that is contrary to the Word of God. So right now we're going to command our morning, and we're going to say what God's Word has to say about us. And the Word of God says that I am a child of the Most High God. The Galatians 3:26 says, for you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. I am redeemed from the hand of the enemy, because Psalm 107:2 says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from the hand of the enemy. I am forgiven of all my sins and washed in the blood of Jesus, because Colossians 1:14 tells the believer, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. I am saved by grace through faith. Ephesians 2:8 lets us know, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. I am a new creation, because 2 Corinthians 5:17 tells me that therefore if anyone be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away, behold, all things have become new. I am delivered from the power of darkness, and I'm reminded of Colossians 1:13. It says, he has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of his love. I am led by the Spirit. I trust in the Lord with all my heart and lean not unto my own human reasoning. Romans 8:14 says, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. I thank you that I am protected by angels, as Psalm 91:11 says, for he shall give his angels charge over me to keep me in all my ways. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. I am doing all things because God has called me to do through Christ. Philippians 4:13 says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I am getting my needs met today. I am getting my needs met. Philippians 4:19 says, and my God shall supply all my needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. I am casting my cares upon the Lord, because 1 Peter 5:7 says, casting all my cares upon him, for he cares for me. I'm trying to make it personal this morning. I am strong in the Lord and in the power of his might, because Ephesians 6:10 says, finally, brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. I today am putting on the whole armor of God so that I can stand against the wiles or the strategies of the devil. As Ephesians 6:11 says, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against against the wiles of the devil. I am blessed coming in, Pastor Wright. I am blessed going out. Because Deuteronomy 28, oh God, one of the blessings says, verse number 6, blessed shall you be when you come in, and blessed shall you be when you go out. I am blessed with spiritual blessings, because Ephesians 1 and 3 says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. Today, I, as Pastor Wright, as Pastor Anderson has encouraged us, I am exercising my authority this morning. I have authority over the enemy. Luke 10:19 says, behold, I give you authority to trample on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt me. I am the head and not the tail. I am above and not beneath. Because Deuteronomy, the word says in verse number 13, and the Lord will make me the head and not the tail. I shall be above only and not beneath. Oh God, I am not moved by what I see in the natural, because 2 Corinthians 4:18 says, while we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen, for the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. I am determined to walk by faith and not by sight, because the word tells me in 2 Corinthians 5:7, for we walk by faith and not by sight. I am bringing every thought into captivity. I have the mind of Christ. My mind is being renewed daily. 2 Corinthians 10:5, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Romans 12:2 says, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Thank you so much, Pastor Anderson. We have the victory when we know the word, when we believe the word, and we apply the word. And the word in 1 John chapter 5, verses 4 and 5 says, for every child of God defeats this evil world, and we achieve this victory through our faith. And who can win this battle against the world? Only those who believe that Jesus is the Son of God. For those who believe that this morning, for those who are understanding that you can be in control of your inheritance, for those who believe that Jesus is the Son of God, for those that are determined to walk in the instruction that we've been given from Pastor Anderson when he said, let's grow up and let's receive our inheritance. For those that are willing to do that this morning, I encourage you to declare, I win, I am victorious, I am in control of my inheritance. John P. Key is going to take us home with I Believe. Those on the call, please remain on the line.
Come on.
Come on.
Yeah, yeah.
Come
yeah. He'll give me all I need. Oh, where my church people? Oh, there they are, there they are. Here, here. Oh, he'll give me everything I need. Oh, I've been. Y'all play it one time for me. Come on. I'll have my mansion now. That's right, right there. Mr. Clarence, I'm going to take him back. Watch this, Mr. Clarence. Oh, he'll do. He'll do. He'll do. Yes, he'll do.
And friends, for the last hour, you have been listening to Command Your Morning Prayer Line live this morning from the Upper Room Ministries Incorporated, 702 R.C. Davis Parkway out of Waycross, Georgia. For the pastor there is none other than Pastor Samuel Sellers III, the host of Command Your Mornings, Evangelist Dr. Renee Sellers, unless a designate. Join us Monday morning, 5 a.m. until 6 a.m., when Command Your Morning once again return to the airways here on WHLJ, 97.5 FM. Command Your Morning is a service of the Upper Room Ministries Incorporated, 702 R.C. Davis Parkway, out of Waycross, Georgia, Esquire County. Up next, the Ricky Smiley Morning Show.